It's been over 30 years since the collapse of the Soviet Union, but the now defunct nation continues to be studied and debated in both public and academic circles. It was a country that was forged in revolution, regicide, terror, and warfare. It was also the country that launched the first human beyond the atmosphere, while also attempting to reshape society into something new and improved. To say the Soviet Union left a very complex legacy behind it would be an understatement of gross proportions. Among the questions widely debated in academic circles, and certainly in YouTube comments, is whether or not the USSR was an empire. I'm your host David, and today we are going to examine the question and see if we can't provide an answer. This is The Cold War. Okay, so the question is, was the USSR an empire? Well, the short answer is yes. Now, for those of you who haven't immediately descended into the comments section to denounce me, the channel, and everyone involved with it, it's important to understand how we arrived at this conclusion. This means we are going to take a slightly different direction this week and delve into the world of political science and cultural history before returning to the more familiar shores of global diplomatic history. We'll start by looking at the definition, in a political sense, of what an empire is and include some historical examples before broadly going over the USSR's history to show how it fits, more or less, into the characteristics of what has broadly been considered an empire in political terms. It's important to note, for those of you who will pick up on one or more contradictions in what I'm arguing, that definitions in political science are never exact and need a degree of flexibility, as no two nations are ever the same. For our purposes, however, it's a useful tool for better understanding regime type and how nations fit together. We're also going to discuss cultural hegemony. Empires of various shades often seek to exert a dominant or singular culture, even as other cultural groups exist within its boundaries. Finally, there is the dimension of foreign affairs. Empires are often characterized by a strong competition with a rival hegemon and a coercive form of diplomacy that seeks to subjugate neighboring states. Okay, so let's start with some basic definitions. What exactly is an empire, and how is it different from a nation, kingdom, or religious oligarchy? Well, Merriam-Webster defines an empire as, quote, a major political unit having a territory of great extent or a number of territories or peoples under a single sovereign authority. It does note that empires, as we typically understand them, have an emperor as a chief of state. However, other definitions, such as Oxford, stipulate that an empire can be ruled by a, quote, monarch, oligarch, or sovereign state. So, taking a step back then, we can see that we have arrived at this definition by categorizing what empires have been historically. They are supranational, often multi-ethnic states, governed in a largely autocratic and non-democratic manner. The non-democratic aspect is very important, as it speaks to how societies organize themselves. Broadly speaking, democratic nations derive legitimacy from the consent of their people to be governed. Authoritarian states, on the other hand, have a different source of legitimacy, generally some kind of national or imperial ideology, often upheld by the use of force. That is, of course, a separate debate and one which we should just avoid for the time being. But returning to the topic at hand, we should ask why the supranational aspect is important. In fact, some of you may be asking what supranational even means. Well, it means that a state consists of more than one nation. The USSR's immediate predecessor, the Russian Empire, was indeed an empire that fits this definition neatly. There were over 100 ethnic and linguistic groups within the Russian Empire and more than one nation. Legally, the Russian Emperor was also the King of Poland and the Grand Duke of Finland. Russia was a unitary, federated empire. This means it had one central government headed by the Tsar, which imposed laws and edicts onto its constituent parts. Though the subject nations and peoples retained some rights and prerogatives, they had no recourse should the Tsar choose to break them. This is in contrast to other historical empires, such as the Holy Roman Empire, which is the example of the extreme opposite of unitary federated empire, a confederated empire. In the Holy Roman Empire, emperors were elected and princes, dukes, barons, bishoprics, and even some cities had extensive rights and avenues of recourse against the emperor. The happy medium, which doesn't call itself an empire, although technically it fits the definition, would be the United Kingdom, where before the Devolved Government Act, there was a single parliament, but Scotland and Ireland technically had their own law courts and certain rights. Keep in mind, in terms of the definition, that Wales didn't have the same rights as Scotland or Northern Ireland, and all three have very, very long lists of grievances. Very long. You may now all descend into the comments section again to tell us how wrong we are. So again, this is a very general overview, but helps us establish a working definition of what empires are internally. Now, in anticipation of your next question, yes, these are all hereditary or elected monarchies. However, it should fascinate you to learn that though the shape and name of government institutions have changed over time, the core aspects have largely remained unchanged. You have executive authority, or the enforcement of law, legislative authority, or the making of laws, and judicial authority, the justification of law through jurisprudence. In some nations, these are separated into different branches of government, while in others they are combined into one. Before the Great War, that's the First World War, by the way, most of the world was governed under some form of supreme executive, usually exercised by a monarch. Over time, in many nations, legislatures and courts have taken greater authority, creating more balanced systems. So, with all of this in mind, let's now turn our attention specifically to the Soviet Union. The USSR was established by the Union Treaty of 1922, specifically to address the question of how to reconcile the Russian Empire's multi-ethnic and multinational status with Lenin's interpretation of Marxism. Stalin, who was at the time the People's Commissar for Nationalities, had wanted a unitary Russian socialist state, though with some local, meaning false, autonomy for various ethnic groups. Lenin, however, disagreed, and insisted the USSR needed to be a state that could provide an alternative to what he labeled bourgeois nationalism by creating socialist nationalism. Lenin postulated that socialist nationalism would simultaneously appease people's desire for recognition of their ethnic identities, but at the same time help them recognize their common class identity and bind them together in what could perhaps be a global federation of socialist states. Lenin also hated and despised Russian nationalism as he saw it as a fount of imperial oppression, though it is worth noting here that combating bourgeois nationalism included the repression of various national leaders, as well as intellectuals and spiritual authorities. Many innocent people were killed or imprisoned as the USSR attempted to reshape society from the top down. So initially, on paper at least, the USSR was a federated, democratic, supranational entity akin to the contemporary EU with a far stronger central government. In actuality, though, it was a multi-ethnic, multinational oligarchy that for much of its history saw judicial, executive, and legislative authority contained within the party, and during certain periods, the party was just a tool of the person in charge. Stalin is perhaps the best example of this, although Brezhnev was also able to wield expansive authority for an extended period of time. Domestically, there were elections in the USSR, although the outcome was never in doubt, and the totality of party and state control assured that any genuine democratic governance or local autonomy was snuffed out before it could really begin. Thus, the USSR became the latest iteration of the Prison of Nations, where the various peoples who had been under the suzerainty of the Tsars continued to be ruled most definitely without their consent. It's worth noting here as well that the Second World War helped to solidify many of the imperial aspects of the Soviet Union. On one hand, repression of perceived disloyal ethnic communities was greatly accelerated, while on the other, the identity of the USSR as a nation which Russia and the Russian people was the senior brother of the fraternal or lesser peoples. Now, on the aspect of cultural hegemony, we have previously done a more detailed dive into the Russification of Soviet language policy and culture, and that episode is a good starting point for this discussion, so if you haven't yet watched that episode, you really should. Okay, at a more theoretical level, empires tend to have an overarching or hegemonic culture they seek to impose or place in a dominant position on their subject regions. Historically, this is manifested in laws and religion. You will of course recall that even the divided and confederated Holy Roman Empire fought lengthy struggles to impose a uniform religion on the state. In the USSR, of course, there was Russification, but also the creation of the Homo Sovieticus ideal and of Soviet culture. Minority languages and cultures were allowed to exist, but people were expected to be able to speak Russian as it was the primary language of business and government across the Union. Local cultures were allowed to exist, but were considered a relic of the past as the overarching cultural model that was to be pursued was Soviet. There was even a whole school of thought that people of less sophisticated cultures, do with that what you want with that phrase, would benefit the most from good socialist education. This, of course, is a very paternalistic worldview, and though it waxed and waned, as we discussed in our video on the Soviet Constitution, the USSR largely sought to organize and regulate society while expunging and repressing anything that did not fit into the state's preferred norms. This, in many ways, mirrors quite similarly the policies of other European empires, who often created arbitrary ethnic groups as a means of organization and insisted on their own culture and languages as inherently superior to already established ones. So, the USSR, for most of its history, domestically and culturally, fits the criteria of an imperial state. But there is one other aspect, Soviet foreign policy. In particular, its acquisition of territory and its assumption of the right to interfere with the self-determination of nominally sovereign states in its near abroad. Now, there are three sub-points here. One is Soviet policy from 1939 to 1953, during which Stalin made a consistent effort to reacquire territory that had been part of the old Tsarist Empire, including Poland, Finland, and Bessarabia, modern-day Moldova. After the Second World War, some of this territory was directly acquired, while new pro-Soviet governments were set up across Eastern Europe. Maxim Litvinov, the Soviet diplomat and former foreign minister, complained to an American journalist in 1950 that rather than seeking to build a new world order, the USSR had instead opted for an old policy of drawing lines on the map. He thought he was being critical of his rival Molotov, but in fact, this imperialist direction came directly from Stalin. This policy saw communist governments created or supported in Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, Albania, and East Germany. These states became, in effect, vassals of the USSR, bound to its economic and military apparatus by a variety of treaties. The USSR also reserved the right to intervene should any of these states deviate from the preferred policies of Moscow. This happened in 1956 in Hungary when Soviet troops moved to overthrow a rebelling Hungarian government and disperse anti-communist demonstrators with tanks and machine guns. The 1968 crushing of the Prague Spring led to the formalization of this intervention with the Brezhnev Doctrine, which stipulated a threat to socialist rule in any Eastern Bloc state was a threat to them all and thus justified intervention. The interpretations of this doctrine, however, which despite its imperial nature being cloaked in socialist rhetoric, were so broad that the USSR used it to justify their invasion of Afghanistan 11 years after the Czechoslovak uprising. It was fear of Soviet intervention which also sparked the declaration of martial law in Poland in 1981, during which hundreds, perhaps thousands of people were arrested, tortured, and many killed. And for the tankies, who I know will be active in the comments, please take a moment to reflect that the epithet tanky comes from the Soviet use of tanks to put down dissenting opinions, not exactly the hallmark of a free and open society. Thus, the USSR, despite its lip service to the global liberation of mankind under the banner of Marxist-Leninism, in actuality was by its nature an imperial state. It sought to expand its power in real terms and impose control over neighboring states, which it subordinated to it. No doubt, as George Kennan argued, some of this was rooted in traditional Russian paranoia, but it also was a facet of the USSR leadership's belief in itself as a superpower, and thus an exception to many of the universal norms other states were bound to observe due to their lack of military power. Okay, so as we've seen, an empire, especially in the modern age, is not necessarily a nation ruled by an emperor. Rather, it is an autocratic supranational power that can have a unique overarching imperial identity. For most, if not all of its existence, the USSR fit into this criteria. While the degree to which it was self-aware of its imperial nature waxed and waned with its leadership cadres and its social evolution, using the available criteria, we can definitely say the USSR was indeed an imperial state. Thus, its collapse in 1991 might well have been the end of the last empire on Earth. Or perhaps the Russian Federation simply picked up the baton that had been dropped by the USSR and continues an imperial legacy that stretches back centuries. As a final word, I'm quite aware that there will be more than one comment about the imperial nature of the United States based on these same criteria that we've applied here towards the Soviet Union. And that is a very fair argument to be put forward. But it should also in no way be used as an excuse or even a reason to ignore a key historical aspect of the Soviet Union and the legacy it leaves with us here in 2024. Whataboutism is the last refuge of those who have no real argument to make. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss our future work, please make sure to press the like and the subscribe button, and then declare the bell button the one true imperial lord and master, our guiding light in these dark times. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.